world's largest geothermal area is huge and dynamic. Offering a glimpse into forces of Earth's creation. In this showcase of the natural world, wildlife thrives. A thousand Yellowstone wonders are calling, declared wilderness prophet John Muir in 1898. Look up and down and around about you. Today, millions of people from all corners of the globe answer the call. They come to celebrate the wonders of the world's first national park. Deep in the heart of the American West, astride the Rocky Mountains Continental Divide, the bulk of Yellowstone National Park is nestled in the northwest corner of Wyoming, while two other states, Idaho to the west and Montana to the north, host thin slivers of the park. Four park entrances match the cardinal points of the compass: east, south, west, and north, while a fifth is located in the northeast corner of the park. The five gateway roads converge on two loop roads that trace a figure eight in the center of the park, accessing Yellowstone's famous attractions. Old Faithful, Yellowstone Lake, Hayden Valley, Falls of the Yellowstone River, Lamar Valley, Mammoth Hot Springs, and many lesser known but fascinating locations. Yellowstone's over 2 million acres are an open door to adventure. Drive the main roads to explore its wonders. Travel secondary roads to find Yellowstone's hidden treasures. For those with more time and a sense of adventure, over 950 miles of hiking trails lead to Yellowstone's legendary backcountry. That is little changed from the landscape that greeted the first explorers. For the hardy traveler, winter is enchanting. Exploring Yellowstone is an adventure, a chance to walk in the footsteps of pioneers who created an American legacy. The wilderness of Yellowstone is little changed from when Native Americans first walked these lands centuries ago. For generations, this place lived only in the lore of Indians. Over time, white men, trappers, and hunters mostly, began telling far-fetched tales of a mysterious western wilderness. The hardy explorer John Coulter was perhaps the first white American to wander into the land, breaking ranks with Lewis and Clark's Corps of Discovery on the return from the Pacific in 1806. Coulter set out on a trapping mission, but was awed instead by the natural wonders he tried to describe to doubting listeners. Soon, other mountain men followed Coulter, roaming beyond the frontier. Jim Bridger was considered the greatest mountain man of them all. It was Bridger who entered this little-known realm in 1830. When he returned to the known world, his stories poured forth. Great springs are so hot that meat is cooked in them. Geysers spout up 70 feet high with a terrific hissing noise. While many considered his stories too fantastic to be believed, others decided to see for themselves. It wasn't until 1871, as part of the Hayden Expedition, when artist Thomas Moran and photographer William H. Jackson recorded its wonders, that Americans got an inkling of the area's grandeur. A movement to preserve this special land convinced the U.S. Congress to protect the area. Finally, on March 1, 1872, President Ulysses S. Grant signed a bill setting aside Yellowstone as the world's first national park. At first, Yellowstone was at the mercy of poachers illegally hunting animals and visitors degrading formations. The park had no regulations or funding. In 1886, the cavalry rode to the rescue and began to police the park. At first, it was a frontier assignment until the Army built Fort Yellowstone, which stands today at Mammoth Hot Springs. 35 buildings remain from this period, including the Bachelor Officers' Quarters, which is now the Albright Visitor Center. The Army solely administered Yellowstone until 1916, when the National Park Service was created. The two entities then jointly administered the park until the Army left in 1918. The Museum of the National Park Ranger near Norris offers a fascinating glimpse into the story of the Park Service. From military beginnings, the role of the ranger has evolved into a diverse field of professionals. Railroads were early promoters of the fledgling national park. Trains arrived just outside Yellowstone at the north, just 11 years after the park was founded. From the train depot, travelers rode horses or stagecoaches into the park on the Grand Tour. To accommodate the early visitors, hotels sprang up inside the park. Still operating, the Old Faithful Inn and the Lake Hotel. Another park icon, the Roosevelt Arch, is located at the north entrance of the park. President Theodore Roosevelt dedicated this cherished arch in 1903. This concept to preserve special lands has spread. Today, national parks are found in almost every country on the globe. Yellowstone is a legacy, not only to America, but to the world. The Grand Tour is what they called the stagecoach exploration of Yellowstone at the turn of the 20th century. From geysers to grizzlies, Yellowstone's diversity still astounds. Today's travelers roughly follow the same pioneer trails around the center of the park. The Roosevelt Arch is the northern gateway to Yellowstone's wonders. Bighorn sheep on the cliffs may greet the sharp-eyed visitor on the way to Mammoth, where the park headquarters are open year-round. Mammoth Hot Springs' tremendous travertine terraces change almost daily. The limestone rock underneath makes this area special. Carbon dioxide in the hot water dissolves the limestone as it flows upward. Reaching the surface, the calcium carbonate is deposited as travertine terraces. The best example of travertine hot springs in the world has been described as a cave turned inside out. Mammoth Hot Springs deposits nearly 2 tons of travertine per day. Old springs die and then come to life again as the amount and direction of water changes, an incredible display of nature's power. On the way up Golden Gate, you might chance upon a black bear in the hoodoos. Before Norris Junction, you'll pass Roaring Mountain, where the hillside is covered in hissing fumaroles. The roar has diminished since it was first named, but it remains an impressive feature. Norris Campground was named for the early park superintendent, who loved buckskin attire and laid out early trails. Norris is one of a dozen camping areas. Norris Geyser Basin is the hottest and most dynamic geyser basin in the park. The color patterns are different from other geyser basins because of the acidic nature of the water. The world's largest geyser. Steamboat geysers' eruptions can be years apart, but when they occur, it explodes to heights of 300 feet. Echinus Geyser is the largest acid water geyser in the park. At the end of its eruption, the pool will be almost drained of water. Norris is the oldest geyser basin in Yellowstone, and also the hottest. We are standing on a supervolcano. On the Grand Tour, the old stagecoach road traveled from Madison Junction alongside the Firehole River to Old Faithful. The Madison River flows the year round and is prime wildlife viewing. Firehole Canyon Drive, once the main highway into Old Faithful, is now a delightful side trip. The swimming hole on the Firehole River is fun for all ages. Grab your suit, hop in. The thermal heated water is a warm 75 to 80 degrees during the summer. Lower Geyser Basin is the first of three geothermal areas leading to Old Faithful. Here, Clepsydra Geyser erupts continuously. Nearby, Fountain Paint Pot is the most famous of Yellowstone's mud pots. Firehole Lake Drive offers a great series of geothermal features. Including a beautiful 20-foot-high cone geyser, White Dome Geyser. Midway Geyser Basin is home to Grand Prismatic Spring, the largest hot spring in the park, and remarkably, the third largest in the world. The discharge from the Excelsior Geyser is an astounding 6 million gallons a day, enough to increase the temperature of the Firehole River by 3 degrees. Old Faithful is found in the upper geyser basin, which has the highest concentration of geothermal features in the park. In 1870, it was the first to be named and continues to be a star attraction. During the summer, hundreds crowd the boardwalk, waiting for the next eruption. Intervals between eruptions can range from 50 minutes to 120 minutes. Old Faithful erupts more frequently than any other large cone geyser in the park. The highest eruptions can soar up to 184 feet, with 130 feet being the average. Almost as famous as Old Faithful Geyser is the Old Faithful Inn, which stands next to the geyser. The largest log structure in the world was built over the winter of 1903 to 1904 and required 1,500 craftsmen. Its main lobby spans 6 stories with tiers of balconies. The centerpiece of the lobby is the massive 4-sided rock fireplace. The inn's young architect, 29-year-old Robert Reamer's original designs were contemporary, but he was so struck by the wildness of the location, he designed a building to match. He later stated, "To be at discord with the environment would almost be a crime." The style he created, called rustic architecture, remains the standard for integrating buildings into the parks. This is the only geyser area with full-service dining. Old Faithful Lodge and Cabins and the more modern Snow Lodge also provide accommodations. A short walk from the lodges is a galaxy of geothermal features, including Geyser Hills Beehive. Old Faithful is not the only predictable geyser bordering the Firehole River, which runs through the upper geyser basin. There's Daisy Geyser and Grand Geyser, one of the tallest predictable geysers in Yellowstone and perhaps the world. It can top 200 feet. Near the lower end of the basin is a scenic favorite, Riverside Geyser. The 75-foot fountain of spray lands in the Firehole River. Boardwalk attractions include Grotto Geyser and Castle Geyser, with its boardwalk spraying eruptions. Upper Geyser Basin hosts a number of hot springs, including Chromatic Spring, Beauty Spring, and Doublet Pool, among others. Morning Glory Pool's once stunning blue color has faded over the years. Foreign objects, from clothes to coins, have impeded the flow of hot water. Near to Old Faithful are two smaller basins, Biscuit Basin, with Shell Spring and Sapphire Pool. Cliff Geyser's frequent displays often welcome visitors to Black Sand Basin, whose name is derived from obsidian in the sand. It hosts many colorful pools, including Emerald Pool. The drive between Old Faithful and West Thumb crosses over the Continental Divide. And passes a unique lake. Isa Lake is unusual because the water that drains from the lake heads in opposite directions. One side of the lake ends up in the Pacific Ocean, while the other side flows to the Atlantic via the Gulf of Mexico. High and cold at 7,733 feet, Yellowstone Lake is the largest high-altitude lake in North America. It is so large that it has been called an inland sea. West Thumb Geyser Basin is located alongside Yellowstone Lake's west side, an incredibly picturesque spot, especially in the early morning. From West Thumb, the park road parallels the lake shore Bridge Bay is the best place to begin a powerboat exploration of Lake Yellowstone. Bring your own or rent from the concessionaire. Here you can also board an excursion boat for a narrated journey around the Yellowstone Lake. The south end of Yellowstone Lake is a wilderness area. You'll need a canoe or a kayak to access this remote region of the lake. The Lake Hotel is the longest continuously operating hotel in the park. Construction began in 1889, and the hotel opened in 1891. Inside, its comfortable interior reflects the early travelers' expectations of a luxury hotel in the wilderness. Fishing Bridge, where Yellowstone Lake drains into the Yellowstone River, the native cutthroat beckon. Ironically, fishing is prohibited at Fishing Bridge because the cutthroat trout is protected. The Yellowstone River is the longest undammed river in the lower 48. It runs over 670 miles from its headwaters near the Continental Divide to its confluence with the Missouri River. Alongside the Yellowstone River, one of the smaller geothermal areas, Mud Volcano, has a reputation as the smelliest place in the park, a result of hydrogen sulfide gas. Dragon's Mouth Spring has garnered many names: Gothic Grotto, Belcher, Blowing Cavern. Whatever the name, it's a fascinating glimpse at Earth's underworld. As the Yellowstone enters Hayden Valley, it spreads out into a slow, meandering river. The wide open expanse is great bison viewing country. An ancient ice cap, over 3,000 feet thick, once covered this whole area. The sediments left behind formed a soil that is excellent for grasses and sedges. favorite foods of the bison. Bison traffic jams are common. Leaving the Hayden Valley, the Yellowstone River follows the park road for a few miles through low hills. When the placid waters of the Yellowstone River reach the precipice of an ancient lava flow, the upper falls of the Yellowstone drop a dramatic 109 feet. A short walk along the brink of the Upper Falls Trail leads to a viewing platform, an excellent spot to experience the power of the Upper Falls. The river then speeds on its way to Lower Falls. The stunning beauty of the Lower Falls, which at 308 feet is almost three times higher than Upper Falls, makes it a photographic mecca. Perhaps the best known view is from Artist Point on the South Rim. Thomas Moran painted this scene in 1871. His inspiring art stirred the hearts of Americans and played an important role in motivating Congress to create the nation's first national park. Yellowstone has its own Grand Canyon. Though not as grand as the one in Arizona, it might be the most spectacular 20 miles in the park. The canyon drops 1,000 feet and is nearly 3/4 of a mile wide in some places. Glacial age flooding is believed to have carved this deep V-shaped valley. Leaving the canyon visitor area, the drive over Mount Washburn is a beautiful trip with spectacular views. In the summer, the meadows are covered in wildflowers. Bears forage in the rich meadows. At Dunraven Pass, you can take the trail to the top of Mount Washburn, an exhilarating 10,243 feet in altitude. The road down the north side of Mount Washburn leads to Tower Fall, named by the Washburn Expedition. Here the water drops a dizzying 132 feet. Keen-eyed visitors might spot osprey nests in the canyon. Born featherless, the young hatchlings require constant care and feeding. Roosevelt Junction was named after our rough-riding former president, Theodore Roosevelt. The junction recalls the Old West, with its rustic lodge and cabins. Enjoy a wagon ride on your way to a Western-style cookout, or go for a horseback ride through the surrounding hills. On the trail, you'll pass a petrified tree. Not many people realize Yellowstone's petrified forests are among the largest in the world. A short hop off the Loop Road is the Lamar Valley. Nicknamed the American Serengeti, it's a great place to observe wildlife. bison, an elk, and perhaps your best chance to see a wolf. Wolf watchers patiently wait along the roadside, hoping for a glimpse of this elusive animal. Yellowstone's longest season, winter, is a time of intense cold, with much of the landscape locked in a deep snow. While the land appears frozen and lifeless, nature continues during this challenging time. The smallest member of the dog family in the park, the red fox, is an excellent hunter. Even in winter, under the snow, it can detect prey. Some areas of the landscape are snow-free. They benefit from the hot spot beneath the ground. Here, bison and elk find a refuge from the deep snow. The largest waterfowl in North America, the trumpeter swan, feeds on the river bottom vegetation. Winter visitors, about 30,000 strong, experience a different Yellowstone than summer's millions. The park roads are closed to visitors with cars from early November until the middle of April. Guided snowmobiles and snow coaches are permitted from the end of December to the middle of March. Snowmobiles cruise the plowed roads in guided groups. Better keep a sharp lookout for wildlife that also use the snow-packed roadways as trails. This is one of the coldest parts of North America. Warming huts are a welcome place to escape the cold, which can dip below minus 30 degrees Fahrenheit. The Snow Lodge at Old Faithful is a cozy refuge from the chill. It's also a departure point for travelers seeking a quieter way to explore Yellowstone in winter. Lamar Valley is open year-round. During the winter, the highway is plowed, allowing winter travelers a chance to view wildlife. Rocky Mountain bighorn sheep traverse the windswept ridges, searching for food. The bison is well suited for winter travel, using their massive heads to sweep away the snow. Lamar Buffalo Ranch, built in the 1900s, helped protect the endangered bison. Today, the Yellowstone Association Institute runs educational programs at the ranch. To fully understand the legacy of Yellowstone, one must dig into the geology and biology of this rich ecosystem. This World Heritage Site kindles the imagination, offering a glimpse into the past, to the very forces that created the American landscape. Once the edge of the North American continent, the Rocky Mountains now form the spine. Faulting and uplift formed them. Glaciations carved them into horns and U-shaped valleys. Volcanism molded them. Water shaped the canyons and valleys. Generally, geology is measured in eons, hundreds of thousands of years, even millions of years. But in Yellowstone, the very earth beneath your feet evolves daily. A perfect place to witness a world created anew. At Mammoth Hot Springs, each day, new limestone deposits alter the landscape. At Old Faithful, each hour brings a message from deep within, that change is the great constant of life. The land is constantly changing. Its very surface can rise an inch in a year. Below the surface, volcanic hotspots reveal the forces of change working within the planet. In some areas in the park, the Earth's surface is a scant 5 to 8 miles thick, wafer thin by geological standards. Many visitors are not aware that Yellowstone is a supervolcano. Hidden beneath the Earth is a vast chamber of molten rock called magma. About 640,000 years ago, the magma chamber below Yellowstone exploded, sending ash hundreds of miles to the east. The explosion was 1,000 times more powerful than the 1980 Mount St. Helens eruption in Washington State. With the release of pressure, the volcano collapsed, forming the giant Yellowstone caldera, one of the world's largest calderas. At Hawaii Volcanoes National Park, Kilauea's caldera showcases the circular shape common to calderas. Another example is Crater Lake, Oregon, where the caldera later filled with water. Over thousands of years, the Yellowstone caldera has largely filled with lava, and its outline is difficult to see. However, at Gibbon Falls, the Gibbon River cascades over the exposed rim of the ancient caldera. Beneath the surface, the volcano continues to simmer. This chamber of heat, called a hotspot, is the engine that fuels Yellowstone's geothermal features. An abundance of water on the Yellowstone Plateau is one key to the largest display of geothermal features in the world. Snowmelt and rainwater percolate through surface cracks deep into the earth, where the water meets intensely hot rock, heated by magma. As the water is heated, sometimes over hundreds of years, it rises to create the planet's most diverse display of geysers, mud pots, hot springs, and fumaroles, an estimated 10,000 in all. Nature's system of cracks and fissures hidden beneath the ground determine how the features look on the surface. With 300 geysers, Yellowstone has the highest concentration of geysers in the world. A geyser's unique plumbing system causes the superheated water, a scalding 700 degrees Fahrenheit, to move upward, turning to steam. Near the surface, it reaches a constriction. As the steam overcomes the weight of the water blocking it from above, it gushes upward in an explosion of steam and water at the surface, forming a geyser. Because less water is involved, mud pots are different. Hydrogen sulfide is used by small organisms for energy and converted into sulfuric acid. As the acidic mix rises to the surface, rock is dissolved into a mud-like goo. Gas passing through it causes it to burp and bubble. Fumaroles, the hottest features in the park, vent steam like a teapot on a stove. Hot springs are formed without a constriction in the plumbing, so the water reaches the surface more slowly than geysers, sometimes forming beautifully colored pools and travertine formations. The water flowing out of these geothermal features display a rainbow of colors. Minerals create beautiful tints of red, orange, green, and yellow. Other colors come from living organisms. Scientists studying these waters discovered forms of life that seem inconceivable. Because they live in hot water, they are called thermophiles, also called extremophiles, because of the extreme conditions under which they can survive, such as temperatures over 200 degrees Fahrenheit and water that is acidic. Fascinated scientists continue to research Yellowstone's unique microorganisms. To date, discoveries have benefited medicine, genetics, fuel, and many other disciplines. The Park Service closely monitors scientific activities to protect natural areas. Yellowstone National Park protects one of the largest intact ecosystems in the United States. Five distinct communities of plants are found in the park, along with their associated birds and animals. Two small life zones in the park occupy the highest and lowest elevations. The alpine tundra thrives at altitudes above 10,000 feet, where summer is short and conditions are as harsh as the Arctic. The lowest zone is the Great Basin vegetation, found in the north near Gardiner. The remaining area of Yellowstone is covered by a patchwork of meadows and forests. 80% of the park's terrain is forest. Scientists split Yellowstone into three main vegetation zones based on dominant trees of each area. The Douglas fir zone is generally located in lower areas of the northern park. These trees often reach 400 to 600 years of age and have a thick bark that is highly resistant to fire. The spruce fir zone, found in the subalpine areas, occupy the cooler, damper regions of the landscape. Since the lodgepole pine thrives in the volcanic soils, it is by far the largest life zone in the park. The lodgepole pine seedlings require fire to be dispersed and benefit from the wildfires that periodically sweep across the landscape. One of the most powerful natural forces in Yellowstone is wildfire. In 1988, wildfire ravaged the park. The damage seemed catastrophic at the time, but further study has shown the important role that fire plays in nature. For decades, the U.S. government suppressed fires in the western forests. An arsenal of firefighting techniques were developed: smoke jumpers, retardant bombers, helicopters, man against nature. But Mother Nature was not to be suppressed. Fire is a natural part of growth cycles in the forests, and native trees and plants naturally cope with fire. Scientists realized that fighting fires left unburned fuel that could erupt into massive fires. During the 1970s, the park reversed course and allowed wildfires to burn as long as lives and property were not threatened. The wet spring of 1988 followed by a dry summer, provided a dangerous formula for wildfires. The fire season was to be anything but normal. Conditions became so dry that lightning and man-made fires combined to create over 50 wildfires. By July, the fires had grown so large that the massive army of firefighters could no longer contain them. As the towering flames swept across Yellowstone and bore down on the historic buildings at Old Faithful, the heroic firefighters held their ground, and Old Faithful was eventually spared. It was not till the first snows in September that Mother Nature cooled the inferno. Almost 40% of Yellowstone was burned. News broadcasts made it appear as if Yellowstone had been destroyed, but nature proved otherwise. Scientists learned that even seemingly catastrophic wildfires play a vital role in the park. And today, Yellowstone is a shining example of natural forest regeneration. The plants and animals are recovering. As a wildlife refuge, Yellowstone is in a class of its own. One of the few places in America where visitors may, with perseverance and luck, observe bears, wolves, bison, and other wildlife in their natural environment. The American bison, the largest land mammal in North America, is the symbol of the National Park Service and a common sight. The restoration of the wild bison is one of the park's great legacies. During the westward movement, bison were hunted nearly to extinction, and by 1902, only a handful remained in the wilds of Yellowstone, protected in the fledgling Yellowstone National Park. Today, they number in the thousands. And Yellowstone is home to the largest free-ranging herd in the world. These are big, strong animals. The males, called bulls, can weigh up to 2,000 pounds and can quickly accelerate their tremendous bulk to 30 miles an hour. So don't try to outrun one. And remember to keep your distance, because despite a seemingly gentle appearance, bison are considered to be one of the most fearsome animals in the park. One of the most exciting times to watch bison is during rutting season, when males challenge each other in a contest for females. Female bison, called cows, are not as large as the males, but can still weigh up to 1,000 pounds. They give birth to a single calf in the spring. Surprisingly, just one day after birth, a newborn bison can keep up with the herd. Yellowstone is also bear country, home to both black bears and grizzly bears. Early in the park's history, bears were purposely fed, and begging bears were common. Today, the Park Service teaches visitors that keeping human food away from bears helps maintain a healthy population of wild bears. In the early spring, females come out of winter's hibernation with their young cubs in search for food. The grizzly's characteristic dished-in face and large shoulder hump distinguishes it from its smaller cousin, the black bear. Black bears come in many colors. About half the bears are black, while others have a rust, cinnamon, or brown coloring. The black bear's face is distinctive. Notice the pointy snout. They spend much of their time eating vegetation. Their short, curved claws help them climb trees, and in the fall, they munch on the high-fat, white-bark pine nuts. The moose is the largest member of the deer family. The distinctive fan-shaped antlers make it easy to identify the males. These hefty mammals frequently feed on underwater vegetation in lakes and ponds. In the winter, their lengthy legs wade through deep drifts. Mule deer, with their large mule-like ears and their black tail, are an important part of the food chain here in Yellowstone. Given the size of their antlers, spanning up to 6 feet and weighing up to 30 pounds, Rocky Mountain elk are surprisingly agile. They migrate with the seasons. In the summer, they tend to be in the higher elevations. With the coming of fall, the males gather females in small groups. In the winter, they move to lower elevations where the snow is not as deep. The most commonly seen canine in Yellowstone, the intelligent coyote, is a very resourceful hunter and is found throughout the park ecosystem. Often seen alone, they're actually very social animals. In their pack, they often greet and nuzzle one another, much like the wolf. The gray wolf has made a comeback in Yellowstone. Although wolves are infamous in folklore, they play an important role in Yellowstone. The wolves maintain the natural balance of wildlife in the park by thinning the elk populations. After being exterminated from most of the lower 48 states, the wolf was reintroduced to Yellowstone in 1995. Wild wolves from Canada were captured and transported to Yellowstone. After their arrival, they lived in acclimation pens before being released near Lamar Valley. Their numbers have steadily increased, and today, the wolf's future in Yellowstone seems secure. Wolves are highly social and live in packs, cooperating in hunting and with the rearing of their young. They are amazing runners, able to lope for hours without rest. The thrill of hearing a wolf howl in the wilderness is a sure sign that the natural world is alive and healthy in Yellowstone National Park. Spectacular Grand Teton National Park lies to the south of Yellowstone. The road that connects the two parks is called the John D. Rockefeller Jr. Memorial Parkway for the Rockefeller family that helped to secure lands for the National Park Service. Entering from the north, the visitor is greeted by Jackson Lake, which was created by damming the Snake River before the park was created. The Oxbow Bend area, adjacent to the Snake River, is excellent wildlife habitat. The dramatic, jagged peaks of the Teton Range are visible almost everywhere throughout the park. The highest peak is called Grand Teton and rises a lofty 13,770 feet. The Tetons are the youngest mountains in the Rocky Mountain system, but they're made from some of the oldest rock in North America. Climbers from around the world ascend these mountains. During the Ice Age 10,000 years ago, massive glaciers were part of the geological process that shaped the landscape. They carved U-shaped valleys in the mountains. On the plains, they deposited moraines of glacial rock and debris. The beautiful Snake River flows through the park. The river is over 1,100 miles in length, but only 40 miles are contained within the park. Fishermen love its trout-laden waters, and rafters ply the cold waters during the summer. Native Americans hunted and fished this rich land well before the first trappers arrived and named it Jackson Hole. Today, trail riders relive the cowboy lifestyle on the dude ranches of Jackson Hole. The buildings at Mormon Row remain a testament to the hardscrabble pioneers who settled this frontier. The iconic structures are popular with artists and photographers. In the shadow of those peaks, wildlife flourishes. Most of Yellowstone's big animals also inhabit Grand Teton. Winter is a hard time for wildlife in the park. Yellowstone and Grand Teton National Parks are big, but not large enough for all their animals in winter. Elk migrate to lower elevations, and some Yellowstone and Grand Teton elk find their way into the National Elk Refuge at Jackson Hole, Wyoming. Since 1912, the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service has protected this vital winter habitat for one of the largest elk herds in the United States. Outside of Alaska and Africa, this is one of the few places in the world to see such large concentrations of big animals. Traditionally, feeding sleighs were used to supplement the native grasses. Today, concessionaire sleigh rides carry visitors. Heavy draft animals pull the sleighs. The driver's colorful knowledge is a bonus.
So you can actually see these bulls right over here. A bunch of them have already shed their antlers, and some of them are already starting to regrow. So they typically only takes them on average around 140 days to regrow a set of antlers. So if these guys are getting the nutrition they need, they actually have the potential to grow up to an inch a day.
Winters can be harsh, but these elk have a knack for surviving the frigid temperatures. They conserve energy by tucking their legs under them and only moving short distances to graze. Around 80% of the herd are cows and calves. The bulls stay together in a bachelor herd. Bulls spar with each other in anticipation of the rut. The elk refuge is also winter sanctuary for other wild creatures. The timeless patterns of nature endure in the wilderness of Yellowstone. As winter wanes, the sun's warmth melts the snow. For a few short weeks, life explodes across the landscape. Spring is on the move. Summer is a time of renewal. The natural cycles run their course. Before long, the first snowfalls in the mountains signal the end of summer. The aspen change color. It's a time of mystery and transition. Steel gray clouds and a fresh blanket of snow proclaim winter's arrival and an end to the sweep of the seasons. Until the next round, in the endless cycle that is Yellowstone. Here, the Earth is reborn. Each day, each hour, each minute. It is a wilderness as wild as any, and it still blazes with the dreams of its founding. An American legacy, Yellowstone.